Hello, I hope you're all doing well. Is the 2020 coronavirus pandemic over? Well, I don't know. I think maybe the worst part is over at this point, and now we're just waiting for the politicians to end the lockdowns. But winter is coming, and possibly another flu season. Let me start by showing the more optimistic view. This shows the rate of COVID-19 deaths in some European countries, and as you can see, it's dropped off quite a bit. If you compare Europe to the United States, it looks like we're having a second surge. But that might be because of the seasonality of this disease. Here's Italy compared to Brazil and Peru. In the northern climates, the numbers peaked in winter, but nearer to the equator, it was during the summer. In the US, we have states in both climates, and our graph looks similar to those two added together. Yes, it's true that the number of cases is going up, but this may be more because of what counts as a case. If you just count positive test results, that can depend on how many tests are done. Counting hospitalizations and deaths is more concrete, but still complicated. I got these graphs from Ivor Cummins, and you can watch his whole video. I've left the link in the description. I don't have any idea what his qualifications are, but he's using publicly available data, so it seems reasonable. Some people are saying severe lockdowns are no longer necessary. Back in March, when no one knew how severe this was going to be, it was understandable. But even back then, once we saw in Italy who was the most vulnerable to the disease, maybe it would have made more sense to isolate people based on age differently. Children are 1,000 times less likely to die from COVID-19 than the elderly. In fact, this year, more children have died from the regular flu than from COVID-19. I'll show you parts of two more videos, plus a book that talks about some of this. First of all, earlier this month, Dr. Nabarro from the WHO said this.
Yeah, I want to say it again. We in the World Health Organization do not advocate lockdowns as a primary means of control of this virus. The only time we believe a lockdown is justified is to buy you time to reorganize, regroup, rebalance your resources, protect your health workers who are exhausted. But by and large, we'd rather not do it.
And he had this appeal.
We really do appeal to all world leaders. Stop using lockdown as your primary control method. Develop better systems for doing it. Work together and learn from each other. But remember, lockdowns just have one consequence that you must never, ever belittle, and that is making poor people an awful lot poorer.
There's a link to the full interview below. Next, here's part of a video of an interview of three doctors from Harvard, Oxford, and Stanford who wrote the controversial Great Barrington Declaration, advocating something they're calling focused protection. Here's what they say we should do.
And that strategy essentially consists of shielding the vulnerable or investing quite seriously in finding ways to protect the vulnerable, those in care homes, obviously, and stopping infections in hospitals, but also more generally in the community. We think we can do that while allowing those who are not vulnerable to this disease to go out there and get infected and build up what we call and will continue to call herd immunity, which is a level of immunity in the population that reduces the risk for everybody, which of course is consequential, particularly for those who are vulnerable.
This seems to be a minority view among epidemiologists, but it shows that there's no settled consensus. The main reason some of these people are against further lockdowns is that the lockdowns themselves have such bad public health outcomes. People are delaying hospital visits for regular treatments, fewer people are getting regular vaccines. In the US, maybe 85,000 cases of cancer have been missed due to delays in cancer screenings, and unfortunately, so-called deaths of despair are on the rise. This includes suicide, alcoholism, and drug overdoses. There are also psychological and emotional costs, especially for children and teenagers in school. If you want to read more about this, see this book co-authored by a friend of mine who also works at BIOLA, The Price of Panic: How the Tyranny of Experts Turned a Pandemic into a Catastrophe. In the book, they point out that the severe and sudden worldwide lockdowns in March were based on three major assumptions. One, coronavirus is more deadly than any virus since modern medicine. Two, we have proven methods to prevent the virus from spreading. And three, the benefits of these methods outweigh the costs. Then they argue that none of these assumptions were true. I haven't even mentioned the economy yet. Of course, it's good and right to spend money to help people, and every single death is tragic. But a bad economy can also lead to death. As the saying goes, economy is life. So globally, since 1990, 1 billion people have been lifted out of extreme poverty, which is defined as living on less than $2 a day. but the worldwide lockdowns threaten to put 400 million of them back under that line, and poverty correlates to lower health and higher death rates. Okay, so that's one side saying lockdowns are worse than the disease. There are also many doctors saying that waiting for this kind of herd immunity is foolhardy. In response to the Great Barrington Declaration, an opposing group of doctors created the John Snow Memo, saying the infection fatality rate of COVID-19 is higher than other flus, and that there can be severe symptoms for even younger people. Also, it's unknown how long immunity lasts, so we need to keep using measures like wearing masks to reduce infections. In other words, the disease is bad enough that severe restrictions are still warranted, they say. So I don't know what the answer is, but I am hoping that these restrictions end soon. But we may have to wait for a vaccine before some politicians feel comfortable changing their minds and opening things up more. It seems like we should be doing something different than we did in mid-March, since it's been 7 months, and hopefully they've learned something in those 7 months. Also, there's probably a political element to this. I'm curious to see if anything changes after the November 3rd presidential election. Anyway, how has all of this affected me? Well, a week ago was my half birthday. On my actual birthday 6 months ago in the middle of April, I had barely left the house for a couple of weeks, and I thought that maybe I would postpone a birthday celebration for 6 months when things would surely be back to normal by then. Well, here we are 6 months later and things are sort of in a new normal, but not quite like they used to be. I'm still working from home at my main job and teaching math in an empty classroom to students remotely over Zoom for the rest of 2020. We actually still don't know what spring 2021 will look like. The county of Los Angeles is still preventing universities from having classes in person at this point. Okay, so next time I will tell you about my travels, or rather all the travels I didn't do because of the pandemic. Until then, thanks for watching. I put a bunch of links and references to the things I've talked about in the description below if you're curious about any of that stuff. Okay, have a good day.